मीनिंग ऑफ जन्माष्टमी, हु कैन से व्हाट इज जन्माष्टमी? सो इट्स देयर जन्माष्टमी, ओके, जन्म वी कैन से इट इज कृष्णस बर्थडे, राइट? जन्माष्टमी. सो इन द इन्विटेशन ऑल्सो वी प्रिंट श्री कृष्ण जन्माष्टमी. सो देन we go book distribution every day. So generally, commonly people ask this question: how can God be born? So Krishna has taken a birth, so he cannot be God. Then we have to understand from the shastra, it is not a ordinary birth like us, how we take birth. It is not like us. So it is inconceivable, it is transcendental. Transcendental in the sense, it is not under the material modes. It is not under the material modes. There are three gunas, you know, sattva guna, raja guna, tamo guna. This is all modes. It is not under the material purview. It is a transcendental. So we have to understand this from the shastra. So if you analyze our birth first, before discussing about Krishna, Krishna's birth, we analyze our birth. How is our birth? When we take birth, we come out of the womb and there is so much blood, pus, urine, and it's so much pain. So because of the pain, the child cries, the mother also cries. So it is very painful. And we don't want this. But we are forced upon this. We have to take birth. Because of our previous karma, so we are destined to take birth. We are forced. So it is common for everyone. Everyone, when they take birth, it is so much suffering, painful, crying. Anybody is there who didn't cry when they took birth? Everyone, it's very painful process. So it is said in Bhagavad Gita, Jatasya hi dhruva mrityur dhruvam janma mrityasya cha. Jatasya means ja means janma. So Jatasya hi dhruva mrityur. So one who has taken his birth is sure to die. He should die. It's a fact, right? We all have to die one day. So there is an expiry date for this body. So because it's a material body, any material thing you take, there is an expiry date for this tablet, table, whatever it is, there is an expiry date. So this material body, this is made up of earth, water, fire, air, ether, mind, intelligence and false ego. So this is a combination of material elements, this material body. So this material body will vanish one day, it will destroy. Jatasya hi dhruva mrityur, whoever has taken a birth is sure to die. And dhruvam janma mrityasya cha, so whoever has died, they are sure to take birth again. Okay? So this cycle is going on. So we take birth and death, birth, death, birth, death, this cycle is going on. So when we are in this material life, so till we come out of this conditioned life, so till we purify ourselves from this material contamination, so this cycle will go on. So this is our position. Actually, this is not our position. So, it is said, the nature of soul, Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, that avinashi tu tadviddhi yena sarva vidam tatam. Avinashi, vinasha means what? It is destroyed. So avinashi, that is the nature of soul. We never destroy. So, but we are not experiencing that now. We have to die. We are taking birth. So, because we are in this material condition life, so we have to purify ourselves and come out of this state. So then we can experience that avinashi. Will not destroy, unborn, that state will come. But now we are not in that state. So this is a position of ourself, conditioned soul, jiva. So but Krishna's birth, actually it's not Krishna's birth, it is Krishna's appearance. So it is not like this. So, you know, who is Krishna's mother and father? Devaki and Vasudeva. Okay. So, previously they did tapasya. So, they did tapasya for a very long time. They wanted to please Krishna. And they wanted Krishna to be their son. They did tapasya. So then Krishna said, okay, I'll become your son. So Krishna is, Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, ye tamam prapadyante tam sateva bhajamya. So how you deal with me, so in the same way I will reciprocate with you. So if someone wants Krishna as their son, so then I'll become your son. And in the same way, we see in Vrindavan, there are gopis, gopas, there are friends, they are playing with Krishna, they are stealing butter, feeding monkeys, all these playthings they do. So they wanted Krishna as their friend. So when they expect Krishna to be their friend, okay, Krishna is saying, okay, I'll become your friend. And the gopis, their desire is Krishna to be their paramour. So then Krishna is saying, okay, I'll become your whatever you desire. Because Krishna is saying that etama prapadyate tam sateva bhajami. So whatever you deal with me, then I'll reciprocate according to that. So in same way, if you see in Dwaraka, they are queens. So they desire Krishna to be their husband. Okay, then I'll become your husband. So it is not possible for us. So we are conditioned. We are ordinary soul. We are Anu. Krishna is Vibhu. We are small. Krishna is Vibhu. He is big. So we cannot do this. Because Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So he can reciprocate with everyone however they want. So it is not like our birth, like now we are forced, now we are in this human form of life, we have taken this human body. So then once this life is ended, then according to our karma and desire, we get another body. So according to our karma, it might be some other body, like a cat body, or a dog's body, or a mosquito body. We may take some other body, depends on our karma and desire. So depends on our karma and desire, it is forced. We cannot change this. We cannot say, no, I don't want mosquito body, you please give me some ant body, or you please give me some big animal, at least some cat, dog. There is no discussion there. It is just forced, you have to accept it. Like this. So this is our position. So Maya, the material nature, is forcing us to do things. We are under the control of Maya. So this is our position. But Krishna, as we discussed before, Devaki and Vasudev, they did tapasya and they wanted Krishna as their son. Okay, I'll become your son. So because Krishna is all attractive. So Krishna says, Krishna's father. So he gives a definition of Bhagavan. Who is Bhagavan? Bhagavan, the word itself says that Bhaga means opulence. Opulence. So one who possesses all the opulence, then he is Bhagavan. For example, if you say Shaktiman, who is Shaktiman? Not that serial. Shaktiman is one who possesses all Shakti, all power. And who is Balavan? One who possesses all strength. He is Balavan. So in same way, who is Bhagavan? Bhaga means opulence. One who possesses all opulences. So he is Bhagavan. So the definition is Aishwaryasya Samagrasya Viryasya Yashasya Shriyaha Jnana Vairagya Doshchaiva Shannam Bhagati Gana. So there are six kind of opulences are there. So Aishwaryasya. Aishwarya means wealth. He is supremely wealthy. And he is all wealthy. Aishwaryasya Samagrasya Viryasya. Viryasya means he is fully Veera. What do you say? This, Veera, what do you say? How is this? Huh? Sorry? Warrior. But there is a specific word for that. I am not able to believe.
Brave.
So, brave. Chivalrous, okay. Anyway, Veera also you can understand. In the local language also it is there. Aishwaryasya Samagrasya Veeryasya Yashasya. Yasha means famous. So now we are discussing about Bhagavad Gita. So Bhagavad Gita, this knowledge, everyone is reading. Everyone knows what is Bhagavad Gita reading. Yashasya, Shriya. Shriya means beautiful. Beautiful, and you see, someone may possess these qualities. Someone may be beautiful, someone may be very opulent, very wealthy and all these things. But nobody can say that I am all wealthy. So even if you calculate someone, wealthy person, he cannot say that I have all the wealth. He may have some 1,000 rupees, for example, and someone else may have 900 rupees or 500 rupees. Comparatively, he is wealthy, but nobody can say that I am all wealthy. Whatever wealth is there, it is all belongs to me. Nobody can say that. So, Aishwaryasya Samagrasya Veeryasya Yashasya Shriya Jnana. Jnana means knowledge. So, there is nothing unknown to Krishna. Everything he knows. So, he says that Bhavishyani cha Bhutani. Maam tu vedana kashchana. So he, I know past, present, future. Everything I know. But nobody knows me. He's saying. So he knows everything. Past, present, future. Past, present, future in the sense it is not only the time. Each and every living entity's past and present, future, everything he knows. Like for example, particular living entity like me. How many lifetimes I have taken before and whatever I did. And what are my desires, what karma I did, and now presently what I am doing, in future how many lifetimes I may take. So and what, everything he knows. It is not only one jiva, each and every living entity and whatever he does and whatever they did and whatever they will do, everything he knows. So bhavishyani cha bhutani maam tu vedana kashchana. He is saying that I know everything, I know everyone. But nobody knows me. So, Yashasya Shriya, Jnana Vairagya. Vairagya means renunciation. So renunciation, so he is the Supreme Lord, he is the controller of everything. But he accepted the position of a charioteer to Arjuna. So generally, a wealthy person is there, very famous person or very influential person. So he may have his driver. So whenever he wants to go somewhere, he just call driver, come, start the car, and he start the car and go. So this is the, considered as a lower position. Nobody will take up this position because it is inferior. So but Krishna is, he has all renunciation also. When he accepted this lower position. So these are the six opulences of Krishna. So when all the six opulences are fully in someone, then we can call them as Bhagavan. So he is Krishna. So Prabhupada says in one conversation, it is recorded in one book, Perfect Question, Perfect Answers. So you might have read this book, one small book, Perfect Question, Perfect Answers. So in that, the first chapter, first question he asks, that what is the meaning of Krishna? So it's a conversation between Prabhupada and Bob Chauhan, one scientist. So there is a conversation, it happened in Mayapur. So there the first question he asks is, what is meant by Krishna? So Prabhupada replies, Krishna means all attractive. So unless God is all attractive, how can he be God? A man is important when he is attractive. So this attraction is there. If someone is wealthy, automatically he is attractive. If someone is famous, he is automatically attracted by everyone. And if someone is a influential person, a political person, always people around them, because the famous and that influence is there. So Krishna is all attractive. So in material world, you will not find all these qualities possessing one person. It's not possible. But in spiritual world, Krishna has all these qualities in full. So then he is all attractive. So when someone is all attractive, then people want to relate with that person. Correct? If some influential person comes, we want to go there and take autograph, take some selfie and post in the WhatsApp status, I met this person. So a famous person is coming, some attractive person is coming, so we want to associate with them. So with Krishna, devotees associate with different mood, different bhava. So there are different kind of bhava is there, different kind of rasa. So there are five different kind of rasa is there. One is shanta rasa, dasya rasa, and sakya rasa, vatsalya rasa, and madhurya rasa. So in what way a devotee wants to associate with Krishna, so he reciprocates according to that. So as we discussed, Devaki and Vasudev, they did tapasya to get Krishna as their son. Even it is mentioned that they wanted a son like Krishna. So then Krishna said, son like me, it is not possible. So then I'll only become your son. So there is no substitute. He is Krishna, he is the only one. So he became their son. So even when he appeared, so it is not like our birth, as we discussed how horrible it is, our birth. It is not like this. So when Krishna appeared, see, he first appeared in the mind of Vasudeva. So then from the mind of Vasudeva, he transferred himself to mind of Devaki. And from mind of Devaki, he is transferred into Devaki's womb. And then when he is appeared, he just appeared with his Chaturbhuja form. So then Devaki put a petition that, if you are like Chaturbhuja form, then people may not. So then you please transform yourself as a small child. So then Krishna transformed as a small child. So then it is not a common man, he cannot do this. So this is inconceivable, and it is transcendental. It is not ordinary birth, as people generally say. So he has taken birth, he cannot be God. It is not like this. So we were in the association of Krishna in the spiritual world, in Goloka. Then we are put here in this material world, because there Krishna is all attractive. So then we had little enviousness of Krishna. So then we are put in this material world. People are envious. So when someone is envious, so they criticize. So now people who are criticizing, you know, Krishna has taken birth, he cannot be God, how can he be God? So they are all envious of Krishna. So because of that enviousness, they are not able to accept that mystery of Krishna's appearance. But even if someone is envious, Krishna is there as Paramatma in everyone's heart. So Ishvara Sarva Bhutana Pritesha Arjuna Sasi Ramaya Sarva Bhutani Yantra Rudani Maya. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita. So Ishvara Sarva Bhutana. Sarva Bhutana means in all living entities heart, I'm there as Paramatma. Ishvara Sarva Bhutana Hriddeshe Arjuna Tishtati. He is telling to Arjuna, Hriddeshe means in the region of Hriday, in the region of heart. So I am there as Paramatma. Ramayan Sarva Bhutani Yantra Rudani Mayaya. So he said, the Supreme Lord is situated in everyone's heart and is directing the wanderings of all living entities who are seated as on a machine made up of material energy. So Yantra Rudani Maya. So we are in a vehicle, like a machine. So like if someone is driving a car, like a Benz car, so he will not address himself as I am Benz. He will not say like that. So he has this identity. So we are soul, so we are seated in this machine. Yantra Rudani Maya. So in all living entities, Krishna is there as Paramatma. Ishvara Sarva Bhutana. So as we discussed before, if someone desires like Krishna to have a particular relationship, like a son or father or lover or husband, so Krishna reciprocates. So in same way, a person who is envious, in him also Krishna is there as Paramatma. So Paramatma, what he does is Anumanta and Upadrishta. Whatever we desire, he just sanctions. So that is the Paramatma's role. So even a person is envious, so in him also Paramatma is there. So then if you are envious, so then Krishna will give him knowledge so that he can hate more Krishna. Like for example, a thief is there, thief. He wants to steal. Even in thief's heart, Krishna is there as Paramatma. So whatever ideas he is getting, it is all sanctioned by Krishna. So in same way, if a person is envious of Krishna, so you know Krishna will not interfere in our desire, in our free will. We have independence, you know. So Krishna will not interfere. That's why Krishna is saying that sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraja aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami masucha. So you give up, you abandon all varieties of religion and surrender unto me. I will relieve you from all sinful reaction. Do not fear. He's saying. And also he's saying that this is my opinion. So he doesn't force anyone. You have to do this. So if he forces, then there is no free will. So yes, of course, Krishna demands surrender, but it shouldn't be out of force. Like say, like, for example, if a boy and girl, they love each other, that should be, you know, out of love, not out of fear. I show a gun to a girl, you have to love me. Of course, she may say yes, but it is not love, you know? It is out of fear. Oh, this fellow will shoot me. So not this kind of surrender Krishna is expecting. So Krishna has given us our free will, our independence. So with our independence, we have to understand that Krishna is the master, and I'm with love, I want to surrender to Krishna. So that surrender Krishna is expecting. So a person is envious, he doesn't want to surrender to Krishna, and he wants to hate Krishna. So then if Krishna manipulate him and make him surrender to Krishna, then there is no free will for the jiva. So he will not interfere in the free will of the jiva. So if someone is envious, okay, you be like this, be as you are now. So he is envious, but still Krishna helps him. Even a person is envious and somehow he meets a devotee, and somehow he gets some book, Bhagavad Gita. Many times we go book distribution, and we had many different experience that different kind of people we meet, and they just fight with us like anything, why you are doing this, and finally they take a book, and somehow Krishna helps by taking a book. Or see, now devotees went for Nagar Sankirtan. There are many atheists will be there, but they hear the holy name of the Lord, and somehow they get some sukruti. And then later, they may take up bhakti. Somehow, Krishna is helping us, helping them, whoever is envious. Of course, we are also envious, that's why we are in this material world. We are all put in this material world because we were envious of Krishna. So we have to change that attitude. Now that is why we are doing this sadhana bhakti. So, as a benefactor, as a well-wisher, Krishna is always ready to help us. So even in Bhagavatam, one of the purport, in one verse, Shrimatam Swakata Krishna Punya Sravana Kirtanaha Hridyanta Stohya Bhadrani Vidinoti Sumatsitam. He is saying that by just hearing the pastimes of Krishna, Hridyanta Stohi Abhadrani, all the unwanted things in our heart will now get cleared off when it is heard and chanted properly. So in that purport, Prabhupada explains that Krishna is more anxious than us to take us back to his kingdom. In one line, Prabhupada mentions that. So actually, no living entities is interested to go back to Krishna. Because we were envious of Krishna, we were put in this material world, and the nature of a conditioned soul is to escape from Krishna. So we were all trying to escape from Krishna, and that's why we are in this material world. So Prabhupada writes that no one is interested to go back to Krishna. So Krishna is more anxious than us. So when this jiva will come back to me like this? So Krishna is ready to help. So that's why he came, he appeared. He appeared not to birth. He appeared to reclaim the fallen souls. He came and he gave Bhagavad Gita. By taking this knowledge, again we can regain our lost relationship with Krishna. Always Prabhupada says that we have to re-establish our relationship with Krishna, not establish. So the relationship was there already. We lost that relationship. So to re-establish the relationship, Krishna comes and he gives the knowledge, Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam. So we have to take advantage of this. So like how like when you walk on the street, you see many billboards. You buy this car, you buy this mobile phone, you buy this latest model iPhone. What is the latest model? Who knows?
16.
So you buy this, they put so many advertisements, you know. So by seeing this advertisement, we'll be impressed. Okay, it looks good. Okay, let me take it. So now Krishna is appearing here and he is advertising himself. So he is enacting this pastime. By hearing this pastime, okay, it is so nice. Okay, let me go back to Krishna. Let me join with Krishna. So like a wealthy father is there, and his son, he rejected his father and he just went and he is just roaming around the street. And someone is coming and why you are like this? You know, your father is so rich. Why don't you go with your father? So like Acharyas also comes. Not only Krishna himself. Sometimes he sends his representatives. There are great Acharyas. Ramanuja Acharya, Madhva Acharya, Nimbarka Swami, Vishnu Swami. They are Acharyas. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he came. Krishna himself came. As Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So sometimes he sends his representatives. As a representative, a person comes and he tells us, who is your father? Your father is so rich, why you are loitering in the street? You go back to your father. So he is Acharya, Guru, devotees. So devotees are more merciful than Krishna. Like in Bhagavad Gita, third chapter, at the end, in one of the purport, Prabhupada mentions that actually Krishna says that if someone is inclined to do some particular kind of karma, let him do that. Don't disturb him. Like for example, if someone wants to pious activity, which is not bhakti, he wants to do some pious activity, by this he will get some punya. So he wants to do that karma. So let him do that, don't disturb him. But in the purport, Prabhupada writes that Krishna may say like this, oh Lord, don't disturb him, let him do. But devotees, they won't allow. They pull them out and they bring them back to Krishna. That is the mercy of devotees. Like even Prabhupada says that he took sannyas from I think Narayan Maharaj, one sannyasi from Gaudiya Math. I don't remember his name. So before he takes sannyas, his guru Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, he used to come in his dream, and he used to urge Prabhupada that you come out of this material world, material life, to take sannyas. So his guru used to push Prabhupada. Then in one of Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur's disappearance day, Prabhupada gave one lecture that my Guru Maharaj pulled me out from this material existence. So only a devotee does this. Krishna will not do. So as we said, Krishna will not interfere in our independence, in our free will. But devotees will interfere. If someone is comfortably situated in material life, devotees' job is to disturb them. So they mercifully, they disturb them and then bring them back to Krishna. So that is the job of a devotee. So recently Prabhupada was saying in one lecture that what is preaching? Preaching means, exactly he said, Prabhupada, so my dear sir, you please don't waste your time in these nonsense things. You please come back to Krishna and purify your consciousness. So this is what preaching, Krishna is saying. Prabhupada is saying in one lecture. So this devotee does. The devotee's business is to bring the fallen souls back to Krishna. That's why Prahlad Maharaj also says that he is a Vaishnava. He says that I don't want to come back to you alone. I want to bring all these fools and rascals also to Krishna, to you. So that is the compassion of a Vaishnava. So sometimes Krishna appears himself and sometimes Krishna sends his representative. Acharyas, Vaishnavas, Gurus. So they come and help us. So this is the purpose of Krishna's appearance. So like how these atheistic people, they say, no, he has taken birth, he's not God, not like this. So he has mercifully appeared out of his kindness to help us, to claim us back to his kingdom. So that is the purpose of Krishna's appearance. Like in a prison house, sometimes, you know, like Independence Day, Republic Day, like a minister comes and there is some special allowance for some prisoners who is performing well. So they release them. So, okay, you are doing good, okay, you go. You are almost reformed. So they, you just go like this. So like that, in prison house, minister comes. Like this, this material world is considered as a prison house. This is also known as Devi Dham. Devi is also known as Durga. Durga means fort in Hindi. Durga. So this is a prison. This is Devi Dham. This is Durga. So he, in the prison, Krishna appears just to claim whoever is following his instructions. So he comes and gives instructions in the form of Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam. He sends his representative. And whoever is obeying this instruction, and he wants to claim them back to his kingdom. So that is the purpose of appearance of Krishna. So in the fourth chapter of Bhagavad Gita, the conversation. Bhagavad Gita itself is a conversation. Krishna answers and Arjuna asks some questions. So, in the fourth chapter, first verse, Krishna says, Shri Bhagavan Vacha, Imam Vivashvate Yogam Proktavan Aham Abhyayam Vivashvan Manave Praha Manu Ishvakave Pravi. So the Supreme Personality of God and Lord Shri Krishna said, I instructed this imperishable science of yoga to the Sun God, Vivashvan, and Vivashvan instructed it to Manu, the father of mankind, and Manu in turn instructed it to Ikshvaku. So Krishna is starting a new subject, a new topic. Previously in the third chapter they were discussing about Karma Yoga, and in the fourth chapter Krishna is starting a new chapter, he is opening up. So whatever I am telling you, it is not something new. It is very old, many, many millions of years back. I instructed the same knowledge to Vivaswan, Sun God, Surya Bhagwan. Then Sun God instructed to Manu, and then Manu gave to Ikshvaku. The parampara comes like this. So at some point this chain was broken. So then now I am considering you as a representative, and I am giving the same knowledge to you now. It is nothing new. It is the old knowledge, same knowledge, I am giving this to you. Krishna is saying. So then, he is also saying that, Sayevaya mayatedya yoga prokta pradhanaha bhaktosi me sakacheti rahasya me tatuddhamam. He is saying that, yoga prokta pradhanaha. Puratana means oldest. I am not speaking something new, it is old knowledge. Already I have given to Sun God, the same knowledge I am giving to you. And why I am giving to you specifically? Because Bhaktosi me Sakha Cheti. Because you are my Bhakta, you are my Sakha, you are my devotee, you are my dear friend. So you are not envious of me. That's why I am giving this knowledge to you, Krishna is saying. So here Krishna is underlining one point that to understand Bhagavad Gita or to understand Krishna, we have to become a devotee of Krishna. Then only we can understand Krishna. Like if you see, there are many editions of Bhagavad Gita, many commentaries of Bhagavad Gita. Prabhupada says, 50 years back he said, there are more than 700 editions of Bhagavad Gita. Now I don't know how many. So it must be more than that. So but before Prabhupada goes to West, there were so many editions of Bhagavad Gita, but not a single devotee, not even one person became devotee of Krishna. But now Prabhupada went to West and he started preaching Krishna consciousness. Then you will see there are millions and millions of devotees now all over the world. So then we have to understand that how one can understand Krishna. So one has to become a devotee of Krishna, then only he can understand Krishna. Bhaktosi me sakha cheti. So you are my devotee and you are my friend. You are not envious of me. That's why I am giving this knowledge to you. So now all these envious people, so they cannot understand Krishna. Even if you explain to them, like what actually Krishna's birth is, they are envious. They won't be able to understand it because they are not devotees. That's why then Arjuna asks one question that the sun god Vivaswan is senior by birth to you. How am I able to understand that in the beginning you instructed the science to you? So it is sounding logical, right? Like for example, Arjuna is saying that Krishna is younger than sun god. So sun god is senior to Krishna. So how you could instruct this knowledge to sun god? Then Krishna replies that many births both you and I have passed. I can remember all of them, but you cannot. Even when I instruct this knowledge to sun god, you were also there. Arjuna was also there, but Arjuna could not remember. Krishna could remember everything. As we said before, he knows past, present, future, everything. So he could understand everything. But Arjuna forgot. Now that is the difference between Supreme Personality of God is Krishna and the normal Jiva, conditioned soul. And Krishna says that Ajopisan Avyaya Atma Bhutanam Ishwaropisan Prakritim Swam Adhishtaya Sambhavam Atma Mayaya. Krishna says that Aja means unborn. Ajopisan Abhyayatma Bhutanam Ishwaropisan. Saying that although I am unborn, my transcendental body never deteriorates, and although I am the Lord of all living entities, I still appear in every millennium in my original transcendental form. So now we are discussing about Krishna's birth. So here Krishna clearly gives a definition that about his nature. So he is saying that Sambhavami Atma Mayaya. Atma Mayaya means my internal potency. So I appear my internal potency, we are controlled by external potency. They are controlled by Maya, material nature. But Krishna is not like this. Krishna is saying that Atma Mayaya. So he takes his birth out of his own free will. So nobody is forcing, nobody is, it is not like us. He is unborn. Although I am unborn, I am transcendental and my body never deteriorates. And although I am the Lord of all living entities, I still appear in every millennium in my original transcendental form. So like how the Mayavadi says that the supreme Brahman is there. And supreme Brahman is there, absolute truth. And the Brahman has taken a material form like Krishna and appeared. So that is what the Mayavadi philosophers say. So then here Prabhupada gives one very important, very interesting reply to this. Krishna says that in Bhagavad Gita that Kai Krishna Gurmani Amumaya Vartaya Maam Kevi Vartaya Vartaya Maya Vartaya Vartaya. So it is said Kai Krishna Gurmani Gurmani means the most Guna Sattva Guna, Rajo Guna, Tamo Guna, three Gunas are there. Kai Krishna Gurmani Amumaya Vartaya. This is Mama Maya. Mama Maya means it is my Maya, my energy. And Duratraya. Duratraya means it's very difficult to overcome. For a conditioned soul, for a bound soul, it's very difficult for him to cross over this material mode. Right, Krishna, Mama Maya, Duratraya. Maya is very difficult to overcome. And the third man is saying that Maam Kevye Kapatyante Maya Maitam Dharamite. Maam Kevye Kapatyante. Kapatyante means surrender. If someone is surrendering to me, he can overcome very easily. So he is saying that it is my energy. You surrender to me and you can overcome very easily. Like for example, one simple example I can give. Like if you go to one big wealthy person's house, a very big house, and they have some dogs for protection. You try to enter the gate, dogs are chasing you. What is the best way to come out of the situation? Can you say? You are trying to enter the house. Dogs are chasing you. So, with the best way to come out of this, any guess? Yes. Correct. So you call out the owner. If you tell the dog, you please leave me, no, then the dog will not listen. So because the dog's owner is there, master, you call out the master. See, your dog is chasing you. So you tell your dog to keep quiet. Immediately the dog will listen to the master. So now, Krishna is saying that this is Maya, this is my Maya. This is my energy. Mama Maya Bharataya, he is saying. And Maam Kevye Kapatyante Maya Vartaya. If someone surrenders to me, if someone surrenders to the master, servant cannot disturb. So then, the Mayavadi philosophers, they say that the Brahman, the absolute truth, he has taken a material body as Krishna. So this is very offensive. This is out of enviousness. So actually the point is, if the Supreme Person has taken a material body, in the sense he is covered by the material guna. So here Krishna is clearly saying that this is my Maya, this is Mama Maya. So his energy cannot cover him. So for example, I have some 1,000 rupees. This 1,000 rupees is my energy. This energy should serve me. With this energy, whatever I want, I can do. This energy cannot bind me. So in same way, Krishna is saying that this is Mama Maya, this is my Maya. So the Maya is a obedient servant of Krishna. So Maya's job is to test all the conditioned souls. Like for example, you go to an interview to apply for a job. The interviewer will ask you many questions. The interviewer's intention is not to kill you. He is trying to test you that whether are you qualified to do this job or not. So same thing Maya is doing. Now we are in this material world. Now we are in the case of Krishna. So now if you want to go back to Krishna, are you qualified? The test that is given by Maya. So Maya is a servant of Krishna. So when we take shelter of Krishna, Maya cannot touch us. So the Bhagavad philosophers, what they say is, you know, Krishna is covered by Maya. If that is what they say, the Brahman has taken a material body and came as Krishna. So Prabhupada says many times that he came as a corporate he is saying about politician or Bhagavad Gita commentator saying that Krishna is saying manmana bhavmat bhakto vajyasi bhavmana suru. Krishna is saying that manmana bhavmat bhakto, you become my devotee and you offer my obeisance to me. But this commentator is saying that it is not to Krishna, it is within Krishna. It is someone who is within Krishna. So it means that he is differentiating Krishna's body and Krishna. There is no difference between Krishna's body and Krishna. There is no inner doubt. So here Krishna says that Ajopisana Priyatma Bhutana Vishwa Pisana Pratyakim Swam Adhishtaya Sambhavani Atma Maya Atma Maya. So there is no inner doubt. So out of enviousness, people say many things that Krishna has born, he has taken a material body. Krishna has never born. He is clearly saying that Ajo Krishna Maya. Ajo means unborn. He is transcendental. So now, after 2 days, we will be celebrating Krishna's Janmashtami. So one should understand this philosophically. When someone understands this, what do you get? Krishna says in the next verse, not the next verse, in the upcoming verse, that Janma Karma Chumeti Nitam Devam Yogi Chakvata Ketva Devam Purajama Veti Mamati Swarma. Janma Karma Chumeti Nitam, Nitam is transcendental, it is not part of this material world. So Krishna's appearance and disappearance, Krishna's activities, this is all transcendental. So when someone understands this tatpata, philosophically, if someone understands this, what do you get? Tekva deyam, when we leave this body, punarjanma nahi, there is no punarjanma, we will not come back to this material world. And where do you go? Maam iti swarma, you will come back to me. So then, that is the result of understanding Krishna's janma and karma has become transcendental. So what we are discussing today is how can God be born? This is a common question all atheistic people, all Mayavadis, they ask. So if they just read Bhagavad Gita, we can understand what actually Krishna is. Krishna, in each and every verse, Krishna is very clearly saying that I'm transcendental. There are so many words. You see, when Krishna is saying the 14th chapter, last verse, Brahman of Yudhishthira, I am the basis of Brahman. So, by the mercy of Prabhupada, we are able to understand tatpada. Philosophically, we are able to understand who Krishna is. So, that is we already mentioned. That the devotee is more merciful than Krishna. That's why after 2 days, Janmashtami is there, and after the Prabhupada's appearance. Prabhupada's appearance is more important than Krishna Janmashtami for us. Because we don't know who is Krishna, but we know Prabhupada. Prabhupada gave us Krishna. Because we cannot directly approach Krishna. So Prabhupada, mercifully, he came and he gave
can be Krishna. Once in Maharaj was saying, it came in nature. We have to celebrate Prabhupada's appearance today more elaborate, more gorgeous than in our human. Because we are just blind, we don't know who is Krishna. If you would have not read Prabhupada's Bhagavad Gita, you would be just roaming around like dogs. Dogs, they run around with four legs and we are just running around with four wheels. It's not a Krishna. So by the mercy of Prabhupada, we are able to understand who is Krishna. So it is a mercy of Vaishnava, it is a compassion of Vaishnava. So with this we conclude. The conclusion is, how can God be born? Answer for this question is, why not? He can do that. He is Swaraj. Swaraj means he is supremely independent. He can do whatever he wants. But he does this out of his free will, out of his own free will, not by force. Not like us. We take birth, we suffer, not like us. Krishna's appearance is transcendental. It is not part of this material world. Hare Krishna, any questions? Thank you.